T-Rex is one of just a few animals that are on a very short list of animals that may have had the strongest bites ever in the history of the fossil record. They had massive, bulky jaws and teeth that would have helped them to apply forces of multiple tons to whatever they were trying to bite. But the juveniles didn't have this kind of structure in their skulls. They had relatively slender, gracile jaws and skinny teeth that were used more for cutting rather than crushing prey. And so this brings up a question of essentially how hard could juvenile T-Rex actually bite? Now, there have been some studies on this in the past, but they've not really used direct modeling and experimentation to try and find this, instead just kind of making estimates based off the bones. There have been some papers that have tried to already suggest some numbers, and they essentially just looked at the skulls in good detail and essentially tried to measure how large the muscles that would have gone to these different bones would have been. They also looked at some indentations that are on the bones of some fossils that would have lived around the same time as Tyrannosaurus rex, and were probably actually made by juvenile Tyrannosaurus rex, and that way they could try and estimate how strong it may have been. This paper, though, took a more direct approach, and that's because they 3D scanned the teeth of juvenile Tyrannosaurus, and using a plastic and cobalt compound, they were able to 3D print something that would have had the same strength, mostly, as the teeth of Tyrannosaurus rex. They then put this into a hydraulic press, and were able to essentially test how hard it could have pushed, specifically into cow bones. Now, cow and dinosaur bones are different, but it does at least give us some kind of baseline for how hard Tyrannosaurus rex may have actually been able to bite when it was still a juvenile. While it's really cool to have this kind of data that was done experimentally for the first time in juvenile Tyrannosaurus, there are still some issues, and that's because they only had a few bones to test with. So essentially, they had to retest on the same bones that had already been tested, and sometimes these tests were close to where previous tests had already happened. This would have essentially weakened the bone where the second test takes place, and you can actually see that very well in this graph. Line A shows a very consistent amount of pressure being applied to the tooth for how deep it's actually going. Meanwhile, line B, you can see it jumps around a lot more, and specifically, it dips down very much in quite a number of places, and that's because the bone is actually splintering in these cases. And there's a lot of variability in between A and B, but it essentially shows the point that these weren't entirely consistent. Sometimes the bones were able to hold together for the most part as the tooth penetrated into them. But on the other hand, sometimes the bones just broke and started to splinter, and that would cause massive drops in pressure as the tooth continued to push deeper and deeper into the bone. By studying the indentations on bones that I mentioned earlier and comparing it to the cow bones, the researchers were able to find out that juvenile Tyrannosaurus rex probably bit with around 5,000 newtons of force, which is a little under half a ton of force. So they weren't biting nearly as strongly as the adult Tyrannosaurs were, but they were at least starting to be able to crack bone. And while this isn't probably to the same degree as the adults because they also didn't have those same bulky teeth, it does show that even from a relatively young age, with the specimen they used being probably about 13 years old, they were already starting to develop some of the osteophagy or bone-eating behaviors that we see in the adults. But there's still more information that the researchers were able to get from the indentation marks on the bones in the fossil record. And that's because they're actually very similar to the marks that some crocodilians leave on their prey when they're trying to feed and going through death rolls, which essentially helps to break apart their prey so that they can eat it in smaller chunks. Now, before you comment that Tyrannosaurus rex death rolled, it probably didn't because it almost certainly would have injured itself very badly if it tried. But it would have probably been able to pin down food with its foot and then using its teeth and a similar bite pressure to the crocodilians, been able to essentially pull up different pieces of meat. There's also another set of indentations, this time on a juvenile Tyrannosaurus, meaning it was bitten by another juvenile Tyrannosaurus. But these ones are not the same kind as we find in these prey items. Instead, these ones are more similar to another type of bite that we see in crocodilians. And this is something that's more of a quick, gentler bite, more of a nip than anything that we see when they're interacting with one another in a negative fashion, not making friends with one another. This means that like crocodilians, which do form groups on the edges of lakes and rivers, Tyrannosaurus rex, or at least juveniles of Tyrannosaurus rex, may have been a bit gregarious, meaning they would have hung out together, although not necessarily in an organized way. Not quite a pack, but, you know, they're at least all there, probably for safety, but also to take advantage of larger prey if it does show up. There has been some work done in other Tyrannosaurs, which does suggest those ones may have been living in family groups, and so this may also be the case in Tyrannosaurus rex, which this kind of interaction might support, although it's going to be really, really hard to try and prove that more definitively. But overall, this paper does go to show how just trying to investigate a single function of the teeth can actually tell us a lot about the animals and how they developed growing and potentially how they lived.